Good evening. Welcome to South Asia Newsline. I'm Yeshi Chanzom. Here are the top stories we are tracking for you on Thursday, the 22nd of October. India observes Black Day to condemn Pakistan's 1947 invasion of Kashmir. President Ghani slams Taliban, says no justification for their war against Afghans. And India opens Nepal border in northern Dharchula for Nepalese citizens to withdraw pension. And now for all the details. Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi on Thursday renewed pledge for COVID-19 protocols as he addressed people of West Bengal on the occasion of beginning of Durga Puja, the biggest festival in the state. He also highlighted his government's various initiatives focusing on West Bengal, launching the campaign for the next year's assembly elections with his virtual address.
Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi on Thursday addressed people of West Bengal on the opening day of the 5-day celebrations of Durga Puja, the biggest festival in the state. The Prime Minister renewed pitch for people to follow COVID-19 protocols during celebrations and said Bengal has always led the way. With Thursday's address, PM Modi also launched his Bharatiya Janata Party or BJP's campaign for the next year's assembly elections, as he highlighted an inventory of his government schemes and how they have helped West Bengal.
Mera aapse ye aagrah zarur hai. कि माँ दुर्गा के पूजा के साथ ही आप दो गज की दूरी, मास्क पहनने और अन्य नियमों का पालन भी पूरी निष्ठा से करें।
दुर्गा पूजा इज द मोस्ट इम्पोर्टेंट फेस्टिवल ऑफ बंगाल एंड ऑफर्स अ मैसिव अपॉर्चुनिटी फॉर पब्लिक आउटरीच. West Bengal Chief Minister Mamata Banerjee, who faces a tough challenge from the BJP as she eyes a third straight term for her Trinamool Congress in the state, has opened 200 Durga Puja pandals or massive makeshift tents for prayers virtually and over a dozen in person in Kolkata city.
India on Thursday observed October 22 as Black Day to highlight Pakistan's role in raids in Jammu and Kashmir in 1947, which brought in its wake horrifying stories of mass plunder and killings. A 2-day symposium has been organized in Srinagar city of India's Jammu and Kashmir that aims to bring to light the historical narrative of the fateful day.
The Indian government and various organizations on Thursday observed October 22 as Black Day to highlight Pakistan's role in raids in Jammu and Kashmir in the year 1947, which brought in its wake horrifying stories of mass plunder, killings and vandalism. A 2-day symposium began in Srinagar city of India's Jammu and Kashmir on Thursday that aims to bring to light the historical narrative of that fateful day in 1947. When nearly 10,000 tribesmen backed by Pakistan Army invaded Kashmir to occupy it by force. Consequently, Indian troops were airlifted to Kashmir on October 26 and they succeeded in blocking the tribal raiders' advance.
Kashmir aur Kashmiriyat par 22 October ko jo ghav diye gaye the uske piche pura ka pura Pakistani prashasan laga hua tha. हमें 22 अक्टूबर की वह सुबह भी नहीं भूलनी चाहिए जब पाकिस्तानी फौज और उसके प्रॉक्सीज ने गढ़ी हबीबुल्ला को क्रॉस करके मुजफ्फराबाद पर हमला किया.
द ट्राइबल इन्वेजन ऑफ 1947 हैड रिजल्टेड इन नियरली अ थर्ड ऑफ द टेरिटरी नाउ नोन एज पाकिस्तान एडमिनिस्टर्ड कश्मीर फॉलिंग टू द रेडर्स. रिफ्यूजीज हु वर डिस्प्लेस्ड रिमेंबर द डे एंड हेल्ड अ प्रोटेस्ट अगेंस्ट पाकिस्तान इन इंडियाज जम्मू टाउन ऑन थर्सडे. October 22 is also marked as Black Day by people in illegally occupied Pakistan-administered Kashmir, who have long blamed they are denied basic fundamental rights and are meted out with severe brutality for voicing their concerns.
Pakistan government has requested the UK government for a third time to send back former Prime Minister and Supreme Leader of the PMLN party, Nawaz Sharif, to serve his prison term in the country after being sentenced in corruption cases. Reports suggest that the letter this time has been handed over personally to the British High Commissioner in Islamabad. Pakistan has requested the UK for a third time to deport former Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif from London to serve his prison term in the country after being sentenced in corruption cases, media reports suggest. According to Pakistan's Dawn newspaper, a letter for the deportation of Sharif was handed over personally to the British High Commissioner some 3 weeks ago after he made fiery speech at the opposition's multi-party conference through video link from London, in which he criticized the military establishment over its alleged role in politics. Through the letter, the Pakistani government asked the British authorities to consider cancelling Sharif's visit visa, which has allowed him to live in London on medical grounds since November. Earlier, talking to journalists in central London on Wednesday, Sharif said that the overall situation in Pakistan is volatile and two parallel governments control the country. Referring to the arrest of his son-in-law, Captain Safdar Awan, in Karachi on Monday, he said that whatever has happened in Karachi is enough to prove that there is lawlessness in the country.
मेरा ख्याल है कि अब आज के बाद शायद आपको कोई शक व शुबा नहीं रह गया होगा कि वाकई पाकिस्तान के अंदर इस तरह स्टेट अबव स्टेट.
Sharif, the 70-year-old supremo of the Pakistan Muslim League Nawaz, was ousted from power in 2017 by the Supreme Court on corruption charges. Moving on to news from Afghanistan. At least 15 people were killed in a stampede near Pakistan's consulate in Afghanistan's eastern Jalalabad city on Wednesday as thousands of people amassed to get visas to leave the country. Tens of thousands of Afghans every year travel to neighboring Pakistan to secure medical treatment, education and jobs.
At least 15 people were killed in a stampede near Pakistan's consulate in Afghanistan's eastern city of Jalalabad on Wednesday, as jostling broke out between thousands of people applying for visas. An estimated 3,000 Afghans had congregated in an open ground, which is usually used for sports and public gatherings, as they were waiting to collect tokens needed to apply for a visa. 11 of the 15 victims were women, and several senior citizens were among more than a dozen injured. Pakistan's Prime Minister Imran Khan and Pakistan Embassy in Kabul in a statement expressed grief and sadness over the incident. An official said Afghan authorities had been responsible for marshalling the crowd on the sports ground. Tens of thousands of Afghans every year travel to neighboring Pakistan to secure medical treatment, education and jobs. The two countries share nearly a 2,600-kilometer border.
More on news from Afghanistan. Afghan President Ashraf Ghani on Wednesday in a speech to the parliament said that there is no religious justification or legitimacy for Taliban's ongoing war. Even though the Loya Jirga, the Grand Assembly, called for a ceasefire and a reduction of violence, unfortunately, the Taliban still continues the violence, Ghani said.
Afghanistan President Ashraf Ghani on Wednesday slammed the Taliban and said there is no religious justification or legitimacy for the Taliban's ongoing war in the country. While introducing ministerial nominees for a vote of confidence in the Afghan parliament on Wednesday, Ghani said the Taliban does not have any Sharia-based reason for the war. Even though the Loya Jirga, the Grand Assembly, called for a ceasefire and a reduction of violence, unfortunately, the Taliban still continues the violence. The body of religious scholars, the Ulema, have confirmed that the war has no religious legitimacy, he added. Clashes between the Afghan forces and the Taliban terrorists intensified in Helmand over the weekend. The violence unleashed in Helmand has forced thousands of Afghan civilians to leave their homes, injured or killed many, including women and children. The statement comes as negotiators representing the Afghanistan government in the peace talks with the Taliban are in Doha to help find a negotiated settlement to the current bloody conflict in the country. However, no breakthrough has been achieved so far and the formal talks have yet to begin. Meanwhile, NATO Secretary General Jens Stoltenberg, speaking at a pre-ministerial press conference in Brussels on Wednesday, said all NATO members support the US-Taliban agreement and current Doha talks, but the Taliban must live up to its commitments.
Nepal President Bidya Devi Bhandari on Wednesday inaugurated the reconstructed Rani Pokhri or the Queen's Pond, one of the many heritage sites destroyed in capital Kathmandu in the devastating 2015 earthquake.
Nepal President Bidya Devi Bhandari on Wednesday afternoon inaugurated the reconstructed Rani Pokhari or the Queen's Pond in the capital Kathmandu 5 years after it was destroyed in the devastating 2015 earthquake. Prime Minister K.P. Sharma Oli and other cabinet ministers also attended the ceremony and paid obeisance at the Bal Gopaleshwar Temple at the center of the Mala Era Pond. President Bhandari had laid the foundation stone for Bal Gopaleshwar Temple in January 2016, formally beginning the start of the reconstruction drive of heritage sites around a nation destroyed in 2015 earthquake.
हाम्रा सबै प्रकारका संरचनाहरूको हिजोभन्दा बलियो र राम्रो गरी पुनर्निर्माण गर्न सक्छौँ र गर्नेछौँ। भूकम्पबाट क्षेत्र विच्छेद भएका हाम्रा सांस्कृतिक सम्पदालाई अझ बलियो र मौलिक स्वरूपमै पुनर्निर्माण गर्नेछौँ।
Religious places still remain closed for public as part of coronavirus restrictions in Nepal, which has so far reported over 144,000 confirmed cases with 791 deaths so far.
The international suspension bridge in Dharchula town in India's northern state of Uttarakhand has been reopened for 3 days to facilitate the Nepalese citizens who had served the Indian Army and other Indian organizations and wanted to cross over to collect their pensions. The bridges will remain open for 5 hours for 3 days beginning from Wednesday. The decision to open the border closed since March 23 due to coronavirus lockdown was taken following a request made by Nepali authorities with several retired people seeking to withdraw their pensions from various banks and post offices ahead of Dashain, a major festival in Nepal.
जो है प्रातः 9 बजे से 2 बजे तक झूला पुल खुला गया, जिसमें कि जो नेपाली नागरिक थे जो सेवानिवृत्त हो चुके थे, जिनका यहाँ बैंक में लेन देन हुआ करता था, यहाँ खाता हुआ था, खाता खोला गया था, तो उस बैंक के लेन देन के लिए जो है 9 बजे से प्रातः 9 बजे से दिन में 2 बजे तक जो है झूला पुल खोला गया, जिसमें कि 238 नेपाली नागरिकों के द्वारा यहाँ भारत में प्रवेश किया और 151 जो है भारतीय नागरिक जो है वो नेपाल में गए।
स्वीट शॉप ओनर्स एंड शॉप सेलिंग गिफ्ट्स इन इंडिया हु नॉर्मली डू ब्रिस्क बिजनेस ड्यूरिंग द फेस्टिव सीजन फील एडवर्सली इंपैक्टेड बाय द सिचुएशन क्रिएटेड बाय कोविड-19 एंड से दैट द फुटफॉल इज फार लेस देन व्हाट दे विटनेस्ड ड्यूरिंग द फेस्टिव सीजन लास्ट ईयर।
Sweet shop owners in India are disappointed as there are no buyers of the sweets and snacks amid the coronavirus threat that has been looming large over the country's festivities. Festivals in India are synonymous with feasting and exchanging sweets as presents. Every year, food and confectionery shops across India used to be decked up with customers thronging during the string of festivals starting with Durga Puja and Dashera and ending with Diwali. However, this year, given the pandemic situation, the orders for sweets and snacks trickled down with celebrations being restricted to avoid the infection.
कोई ऑर्डर कोई डिमांड ही नहीं है जी, अभी कुछ कोई डिमांड नहीं है, बिल्कुल लोग बाग जिसको कहते हैं कि कोई क्वेरीज नहीं है, कोई कुछ नहीं है, बिल्कुल जिसको कहते हैं कि जैसे अभी दशहरे पे नवरात्र में शुरू हो जाता था, हमें इतने डब्बे चाहिए, हमें इतने डब्बे चाहिए,
India on Thursday recorded 55,838 new coronavirus infections, taking its tally to 7,706,946 with 116,616 deaths.
Well, that's all we have for you from South Asia this evening. Now our viewers can watch the show on SouthAsiaNewsline.com. You can also visit us on facebook.com/AsiaNewsline and follow us on Twitter @AsiaNewsline. That's all in tonight's edition. We will see you same time tomorrow. Good night.